Hi viewers, I am Dr. Buvaneswari from GBR Fertility Centre and Hospitals. Today we are going to discuss about one important problem, that is tubal factor. Tubal factor means it may have a tubal block or tubes are dilated. Sometimes it is not within the tube, it may be around the tube. So that is called peritubal adhesions. And the last one is that congenital absence. It can be one tube or both the tubes can be absent by birth. So these are the factors which indicates you may not have a normal chance for conception. So everyone wants to have a natural pregnancy and normal conception. So everyone wants to do what can be done. So as soon as you are diagnosed with the tubal factor, and people will get depressed and then they'll be worried because there is no other option other than IVF. So initially IVF was researched and then done for a couple who had a tubal factor. So after some period only the IVF was done for tubal factors only. Again, now recently lot of researches have been done and improvements are happening, so that IVF is done for so many other reasons, but main reason will be tubal factor. So if you are young, you are married only recently and you have a tubal factor, you don't want to go through an IVF procedure at present, so you can consult us and get an opinion. So yeah, I am going to discuss detail about this tubal factor, how can we diagnose, what are the problems and what will be the cause for these things, and then how we are doing IVF in those patients. So first and foremost is tubal factor means the tube, you have a uterus and on either side you have both the tubes. It can be right or left. So tubal factor can affect either one tube or both the tubes. Sometimes in tuberculosis or chlamydial infections, you will have severe tubal damage. So in that you can, both tube may be unhealthy, at the same time tube can be blocked from inside. The tubal block, if it is from the medial end towards the uterine side, that is called corneal block. So if it is towards uterine side and corneal block, we can remove easily. If the block is in the middle or in the lateral aspect with the unhealthy tube, again the tubal block removal will be difficult. And other factor is chlamydial infections and pelvic floor infections and PID. Generally it is called PID. So you have to see whether you are having a chronic discharge or any febrile illness, a severe abdominal pain, then you can suspect of having a chlamydial infection. Sometimes sexually transmitted diseases can contract a tubal infection. So you have to see whether it is an infective cause or some other chronic pathology. If you have a tuberculosis, then it has to be evaluated from the lungs, abdomen and other structures also. So if the TB is diagnosed, you can do a biopsy and then we can treat it for 6 months. And then after that, you have to see whether the tubes are open or not. Then after that, other factor what I said, chlamydial infections, we can treat with antibiotic. There is a course of antibiotic. Beyond that, the tubes can be functional, and if it is early infection, tube may look normal and function normally. If it is a chronic infection, you can see tube block may not be there, but sometimes the tubal function is affected. And other factors like peritubal adhesions. Peritubal adhesions, two reasons can be there. One is that when you have any surgery or previous cesarean, there will be lot of blood and fluid which can cause infection around the tube, so that it will attract all our surrounding structures like intestines, omentum and peripheral structures. So they can come and get adherent to the tube and it will form a mass. So it is called TO mass. So sometimes because of this, the tube may not function properly. Though it's patent, it may not function properly. And another one is that congenital absence. That congenital absence, sometimes you may have unicornuate uterus. In that you may have only one half of the uterus and only one tube. Sometimes both the tubes and the uterus will be very very small and tubes will be atrophic and ovaries will be very strict. Some chromosomal and congenital abnormalities can be there. Sometimes only that vaginal outlet will be there, there won't be any reproductive organs. Those situations again that IVF also is not possible. So when we come to the common causes like tubal block and tubal adhesions, let us see what we can do. So how do we diagnose? As soon as you go for a treatment for a fertility, and if you have finished 1 year of unprotected intercourse and still you don't have a pregnancy, then you are going to approach a doctor. So once you go to the doctor, you are getting a scan done. In the scan, you can make out uterus and ovaries, and you can document ovulation, whether you are ovulating every month on time. So after ovulation, a few cycles of normal dry, if you don't conceive, you have to go for a tubal patency test. It can be either by X-ray or by laparoscopy, depending on your age and then duration of the marriage. So if you do an X-ray, you can make out where will be the tubal block. So tubal block either on the right side or left side, or it is in the medial side, or the full tube, or the lateral end. So you can identify the site of the block, side of the block, and then how extent it is, you can make out. Only in X-ray, one disadvantage is that we may not be knowing that what could be the reason for the block, whether really the block is there or not. Because X-ray is not a 100% confirmatory test. Sometimes you don't push the dye properly, or enough volume is not given, or is there any difficulty in injecting the dye, then you will think that there will be a tubal block, but ultimately you may see that there will be patent tubes on laparoscopy. So that is why the X-ray is not a 100% confirmatory test. So tubal block can be removed by both methods. Tubal block, one is the diagnosis by X-ray and laparoscopy. Laparoscopy is the gold standard, because laparoscopy you can see directly and visualize, and you can see that extent of the disease and healthiness of the tube. And again, sometimes around the tubes there will be lot of problems. It will tell us whether to go ahead with the tubal block removal or not. So generally, if the tube is very healthy and enough length is there and there is no infection around the tube, and if the tube is not damaged much, then we can go for the tubal block removal. And in case if the tubes are very badly damaged and they are stuck to other structures, or associated endometriosis, because of that the tubes are kinked and getting adherent, or some severe infection along with the ovary and intestines, if it is surrounded by those structures, then we cannot do the tubal block removal. But in GBR Fertility Centre and Hospitals, we are doing successfully this tubal block removal because of the expertise of the team and then experience. So what we do generally, if the tubal block is in the medial end, that is called corneal block, we do hysteroscopy. Through hysteroscopy, we do cannulation. Because of that cannulation, you can remove the block so that the tube can be patent at the end of the procedure. So it should be done in a sterile procedure under anesthesia. You should have all the cannulation set that is imported usually. It is a highly, it is a costly one, but at the same time it is worth doing this cannulation, because at the end of the day you have a natural chance for conception. If you don't remove the block, you have to spend lot of money to do an IVF. So comparing to that, it can be tried on tubal block patients. So here we do successfully tubal block removal. Within 2 to 3 months, we see patients coming with pregnancy. So that gives us a lot of comfort and happiness, and also it makes us do more cases. So what we do generally, we prepare the patient before surgery and give a proper counseling. Two things important here: all the tubes block cannot be removed. As I said earlier also, if there is a severe infection damage, you should not expect us to remove the tubal block. But at the same time, if it is very healthy, or even the tough tubal blocks can be removed if the tube found to be healthy. And laparoscopy, it's an advantage for us. So if you see properly, one tube or both the tubes can be removed, and then tubal block can be removed. So after the removal of the surgery, or 2 or 3 months, you can try for natural pregnancy. And if you see, if other causes like peritubal factors where adhesions are common, we can do laparoscopically release of all the adhesions. We can make the tube free so that anatomically tubes and ovaries are maintained. Again, it helps us to have a natural pregnancy. So for the tubal block, two options: tubal block removal and adhesio lysis can be done. And if everything is failing, or there is no healthy tube to do that corneal block removal, then you can go for an IVF. In tubal block, IVF, two protocols can be used. One is natural cycle. If you are young patients, your husband count is normal, only tube block is there, then you can go for a IVF, natural cycle IVF. But if you are above 35 or something, or your husband count also is on the borderline or low count, you have to go for a conventional IVF. So through IVF also you can get high success in the tubal factor. Only one thing is, you should not have an unhealthy tube with a fluid collection. If you see anything like that, we are supposed to remove the tube or block the tube, hydrosulfings, so that you can have a better pregnancy with IVF. So if you have any doubt regarding the tubal factor, if you have a x-ray or if you have a laparoscopy finding saying there is a tubal block or tubal damage, so you can come with your reports for an opinion. So we will definitely analyze and do the best for you. If you have any of your comments, you can put it in our comment box. You can follow us in Facebook, Twitter, or directly with our website. Thank you.